Hello friends, so in today's lecture we'll be continuing the sensor materials and the technologies. In last lecture we have seen about the surface processing techniques. In that we have seen the spin coating type of technology, then sputtering, then CVD type of technologies in which we are depositing the thin film on the surface of the substrate. Now in today's lecture we are moving further with a technology called as a nanotechnology, and we'll just try to understand what it is and how the MEMS are manufactured or how the small sensors are manufactured. So it refers to the dimension of the devices comparable with the nanometers, that is 10 to minus 9 meter scale. So most of the times we will consider the micro miniaturization, that is called as a microsystem technologies, also known as MST. If you have such kind of devices, then that is also called as a MEMS, which is nothing but a micro electromechanical systems, which is a subset of this nanotechnology. So these MEMS devices it consists the two parts, electrical and the mechanical components, and the mechanical components are the moving parts, and it is actuated by electrical part. So the moving part is the mechanical part and the other part is electrical part. So another subset is also called as a MEOMS. So that is for micro electro optical system. So that is based on micro electro optical system. So these are most of the sensors are fabricated with the use of MEMS or MEOMS with the three dimensional devices. So these MEMS are very useful in robotics types of applications or mechatronics types of applications, where you will be using such kind of applications where the MEMS are put on the surface of the body and they will sense the particular phenomena. So the two constructional technologies are there for micro engineering. One is the micro electronics and second one is the micro machining. So the best example is micro electronics. Is we will consider it as a VLSI technology or ULSI technology, or the best example is whatever may be the integrated circuits you have manufactured, that is with the help of this micro electronics technology. And micro machining is for cleaning the surface or various applications, so that you can manufacture a small parts with the help of machining system. So these are the two technologies which are generally used for this type of MEMS. So microelectronics is generally well known in the electronic industry. So we are familiar with how the ICs are manufactured or how the ICs can be developed with the help of the technology called as a SSI, MSI or VLSI type of technologies, and how the number of components are manufactured on a small chip. So that is referred as a microelectronics. So micro machining is the name that is used for to produce the structures or the moving parts with a micro engine devices. That means a micro moving part, if you want to manufacture, you have to use the micro machining type of system. So the main goal of the micro engineering is to able to integrate the microelectronic circuitry into micro machine structure to produce the complete integrated circuit, that we will call it as a microsystem. So the main aim of this micro engineering is combining together the micro machining parts with microelectronic circuits so that you can produce a MEMS or a micro systems that can be used for the sensor purpose. So such systems are typically have the same advantage that it is low cost, reliable and small size. So obviously the small size will be there. Low cost is why? Because it is produced in a bulk. And reliability is what? Because the same technology is applied under the in controlled environment. So the reliability is comparatively high. So if you want, let us consider that if you want to develop an electronic circuit which is a discrete one, then there is every possibility that every component have their own characteristics, their own limitations. So that will create the overall limitation for the discrete circuit. But since the same circuit is manufactured on a single substrate, so the reliability is comparatively more as compared to the discrete circuits. Hence, the ICs are more useful as compared to the discrete circuits. So this is what the advantage we can say that. And since the ICs are manufactured in bulk, the obviously the cost will be less and the small size is also less, as it will be a small size. So there are three types of technique, micro machining techniques are there. So silicon micro machining is there, then excimer laser is there, and LIGA is there. So silicon micro machining, it will be using for the silicon surface. Then you will be using the ultraviolet rays in excimer laser, and you will be using the X-rays in LIGA type of technique. So first technique in nanotechnology is a photolithography. Photolithography is the first technique that is used in nanotechnology. So it is the basic technique used to define the shape of the micro machine structure. So you need to define it with the help of photolithography. So the technique is essentially same as used in microelectronics industry. That means, suppose if you want to manufacture a particular circuit, so you need to first design a circuit, or what we will call it as a, in our terms, it is just like an PCB manufacturing. So you first prepare the PCB and then you install the component. So you have to initially develop your structure, how your structure looks like, and that is then carved with the, or that is micro machined with the help of the techniques we have discussed earlier, the silicon micro machining, the laser technique, and the LIGA type of technique. So these techniques are essentially similar to the microelectronics industry. So oxide layer is produced on the substrate, and the goal of this is to selectively remove a particular oxide where you want to deposit your film, or you where you want to do the micro machining. So here it is the example given. So what is given over here? So you can consider that this is a silicon substrate. So this is the silicon substrate. So there are two types of materials. So first part and second part. So even though it looks like a same, but we will see that the first part, the left hand side part, is for one type of purpose, and second is for the other type. So this is a silicon on which you will grow this oxidation layer, so this SiO2 layer, on which you are forming a polymer photo resist film, you are depositing on that one. Okay, now we want to remove a particular silicon from this silicon dioxide from this one. So you have to put a structure on this one, and that is only, so the process begins with the producing the mask with a chromium pattern on a glass plate. So this polymer photoresist will be of such kind. So here you can see that the sensitive part is exposed to the ultraviolet rays, and that photoresist will remove that particular part. So the ultraviolet rays, when it is focused on that one, so it is shown in C and D. You can see that when you see this one is, so here it is the C part and here it is the D part. So what has happened? Now you can see that this is the mask you have produced. So this mask is when it is exposed to the ultraviolet rays. Now you can see that this much portion is almost removed from this one. Now this is a positive and negative type of masking technique is there. So this is a positive type of the masking and this is a negative type of masking. So here you can see that the negative portion is removed and only this much mask is kept, and whereas here this much mask is removed. Okay, so the masking technique is our two types, positive masking and negative masking. So these are the two types of masking, and the left hand side and right hand side shows the masking types, different masking types. So here you can see that the positive is the left hand side. So here the positive, you are etching the film, that film is removed, and here you will be having a negative, that means only that much part will remain and other part will be kept as it is, and the other part will be removed. So this is a positive type of, this is a positive type of photoresist, and this is a negative type of photoresist. Okay. Now, when the ultraviolet ray strikes the positive, it weakens the polymers and the image is developed. That means this much portion is kept exposed to ultraviolet, and this will weaken this much part, and that will be removed. And here it is the reverse one, this much part get exposed to that one and that will get removed. Okay, so the resist is washed with the help of light struck where the light is struck, and after forming the positive image of the mask, you will get the structure like this one. So the opposite occurs in the negative resist. When the ultraviolet ray strike the negative resist, it strengthens the polymer so that whenever it is developed, the resist will not exposed to UV, the resist which is not exposed to the UV get washed away, and the negative image of the mask is transferred to the resist. So the chemical is then used to remove the oxide where the exposed through the opening in the resist, either it may be positive or it may be removed. Then resist is removed and the living pattern oxide is kept. Now here you can see that oxide which is get exposed to that one, now this oxide previously it was there, now it is removed. Now here it is, the previously the oxide was here, now that is removed. Now you can see that the oxide is remained over here and the oxide is removed from this place. So this is how you will be doing the technique called as a photolithography. The same technique is also used for doping your films or doping the boron materials into your or impurities to your silicon substrate. So this is one of the method called as a photolithography used in nanotechnology. Then second technique is the silicon micro machining. So silicon micro machining, what we are going to do in this one? So there is a number of basic techniques that can be used to pattern thin films that is deposited on the silicon wafer and to shape the wafer into the required set with the help of microstructures. The silicon micro machining techniques are used. So the technique for depositing and pattern film can be used to produce the quite complex microstructures. So the silicon bonding technique that can be utilized to extend the structure produced by the silicon micro machining technique into multi-layer structure. So we can use the silicon bonding type of technique where we want a multi-structure, multi-layer structure. So it is just like an sandwiching. It is just like putting a glass on a glass, then you put an adhesive between the two glasses, then you can fix up the two glasses. The same kind of bonding is possible with the help of silicon bonding technique. So the basic techniques in that, there are the three basic techniques associated with the silicon micro machining. First is deposition of the thin film material, then removal of the material patterning by the wet chemical element, and the last one is the removal of the material by dry etching technique. That means you first deposit the thin film of the material, then you remove the second technique is you remove it by wet chemical etchant and you remove it by dry etching technique. So these are the three methodologies by which we can go for basic techniques in silicon micro machining. Okay, next one. Next one is basic technique for a thin film. Deposition of the formation of the thin film of different material on the silicon wafer or other suitable substrate can be patterned with the help of photolithographic techniques and is suitable for etching technique. We have already seen such kind of you have a thin filming, you can manufacture the thin film with the help of previous techniques. We have already seen how to deposit the thin film on the surface. Then the common material includes the silicon dioxide, silicon nitride, then polycrystalline silicon and the aluminium that you can use it, that can be deposited on the surface of your substrate. The number of other materials can be deposited as a thin film such as gold. Then the photoresist is not tough enough to withstand with the etching is required. In such cases, the thin film of a tougher material, especially the oxide or a nitride type, is deposited and patterned using photolithography. So photolithography we have already seen in the previous slides. So the next technique is the basic technique with a wet etching. Basic technique with wet etching type of. Now wet etching is the blanket name that covers the removal of the material by immersing the wafer into liquid bath of a chemical etchant. So it is just like I'll give you the example of that one. So the copper clad, whenever you are manufacturing a PCB, the copper clad on which you have printed the circuit and you print a mask of positive PCB and you put this after processing, after heating or after drying that ink, you put that into FACL3 and after a certain process, after etching will be happening, the copper which is get exposed through FACL3 will get removed and the copper which is below that ink or the below the circuit which you have printed, the positive type of circuit, that will remain as it is. So this is called as a wet type of etching. This is the example and the same can be applied to this kind of technique. So wet etching is a blanket name where you are immersing the wafer into a liquid bath of chemical etchant. So wet etchant fall into two categories. First one is the isotropic etchant and anisotropic etchant. So isotropic etchant attacks the material being etched at the same rate in all the directions. So etching will happen in same rate in all the directions, whereas in anisotropic etchant will attack the silicon wafer in different rates in different directions. So the more control is required for such kind of etchants. So isotropic etchants are available for oxide, nitride, aluminium, polysilicon, gold and silicon. And because the isotropic etchant attacks the material at the same rate in all directions, they remove the material horizontally under the etch mask at the same rate as they etch through the material. So here it is the example of this one. So you can see that they will etch with a equal rate. So on both sides. So you can see that this is the resist and this is the which is open to this resistance material, wet etching type of element. Then after that etching will happen with the same rate on the both sides. So you will be getting such kind of material, or you will be getting such kind of etching actually you are expecting the itching in this manner only. So the itching should happen like this, parallel to this one, but it will take in this manner. So there are certain techniques by which we can control such kind of itching techniques, where we will be getting exactly 90 degree angle for cutting the material with the help of etchants. So another most popular anisotropic type of etchant is potassium hydroxide, which is safe for using, and it will be a very slow acting type of material. So the etching is done on the silicon wafer, and silicon wafer are the slices that have been cut from the large ingot of the silicon that has grown from the single seed crystal. Now what happens, let me tell you, that whenever you are taking the silicon, that silicon is in the form of such kind of rods. The silicon is in the form of such kind of rods, and these rods are cut with a small size, and we will call it as a silicon wafer. And these silicon wafers are used for oxidation purpose and then manufacturing the particular ICs, and that's why it is called as a small wafers. Just like a potato, you cut it into wafers for wafers purpose. So similarly, the silicon, this is called as a silicon ingot, and that silicon ingot gets cut just like a wafers. And these silicon wafers, this silicon is of the purest type of silicon. This is the purest type of silicon, and after that you have a oxidation, and then you put your etching on that one. After etching, you put a dopant on that one, and I'll give you the example of how the PN junction is manufactured. So if you understand that concept, so let us consider that this is initially, I'll give you the example of this one so that you can understand the concept. This is initially a silicon. So in this silicon, you expose it to the N type of material, so it becomes N type of impurity or N type of silicon. Now on that you put a oxidation layer, and after that what will happen, you remove this oxidation layer from here, and after removing that, what will happen to this one? So you can get, just a minute, so you are going to remove this one, okay? So this part will be removed. Then after removing, so the process we have already seen in lithography. So after removing, you add your pentavalent trivalent impurity to this one, and depending on how much time you dope it and how much time what is the impurity concentration, depending on the depth of the well is decided, and that depth of the well is again depending on the technique and the control of the doping technique. So this P type of material is formed. So you will be getting the PN junction diode like this, and after that again you grow epitaxial growth on that oxide layer, and that oxide layer will form a PN junction, and again you cut it over here, you have a metal over here, and this P will be N type of material will be there, and here you will have a P type of junction. So this will become anode and this will become a cathode. So this is how you will be getting different types of material. PN junction is formed. So the same technique is used, wet etching. I have already given you the example of developing the PCB in FeCl3. So the simplest structure, you will be using the KOS to etch the silicon wafer with the most common crystal orientation. So if you have a common crystal orientation, if the crystal orientation is different, obviously you will be getting a grooved type of structure, and if the crystal orientation is same, then you will get a sharp cut or a smooth type of etching. So here the example is given. Two types of etching is done with the two types of mask. Now you can have this a particular angle, this angle here up to this portion. This is the oxide layer. The upper layer is the oxide layer. So this is the oxide layer, and this is you are having a sharp 90 degree cut, and after that you will be having a particular angle of 54.7 degree. So that you can manage it with the help of this KOH, because the KOH is operating very slowly on the etching in the etching process. So that's why the KOH is preferred for etching purpose. So the using wafers with a different crystal orientation can produce the grooves or the pits on a vertical walls. So if you have the common crystal orientation, then you don't get a grooves or pits on the vertical walls. Otherwise you will get a grooves or pits on the vertical walls. So both the oxides for a shorter period and nitrides etch slowly in KOH. So if you are using oxide, then you have to keep it for a shorter period, and if the upper layer is of nitride type, then you have to keep it for longer period when you are using the KOH. So the KOH can also be used to produce the mesa type of structure, in which the corners can be welded, and rather than the right angle. That means you can have a different types of corners rather than, or you can have a different shapes rather than having a right angle corner. So here it is the example. You can see that a tapered type of structure is there. So it will look like the etching will look like this one. So you can have the etching like this. So this is the etch mask. You will keep it as it is, and after that you can have such kind of just a minute. And you can have such kind of tapered type of corners are also quite possible. So etching mask, you can have a different type of mask again. So you can see that here it is a tapered one type of different angles you can get rather than sharp 90 degree. So sharp 90 degree, this is a sharp 90 degree I can consider, and this is a tapered type. You can have a different angles rather than 90 degree. So the fabrication of the diaphragm is one of the most popular sensor process. So this is used for producing the accelerometer, the pressure sensors, then the infrared temperature sensors, specifically thermopiles or bolometers, and many others. So you will be using the fabrication of diaphragm. So using such kind of techniques also you can prepare the diaphragm in silicon. How to do it? Let us try to see it. So the silicon diaphragm, which is of the size of or which is of the thickness of 50 micrometer thick upward, can be made etching through the entire wafer with KOH type of film. So the thickness can be controlled by the timing of the etching and thus subjected to the error. So if your control will be different, obviously the thickness is going to hamper because of that one. So here it is, you can see that how exactly the silicon wafer will be formed with a diaphragm. Now you can see that this is the silicon metal on which you have a oxide, and after that you etch it in a reverse manner, and you simply put it in a different. So I can say that what we'll say. So this is a silicon. So on that silicon you will have this oxide. So this oxide is there. Now you with the help of photolithography what you will do, with the help of photolithography you simply cut it over here, and after cutting what will happen, you will etch it. So you will teach it in such a way that it will have such kind of grooves. You will have such kind of cutting, and this cutting is up to this one. Okay, so this much portion is etched. This much portion is etched with the silicon, and then you revert it. You simply change the direction of that one, and on that surface you have this boron doped silicon. You have this boron doped silicon. So this boron doped silicon will act as a diaphragm. This boron doped silicon will act as a diaphragm. So the thinner diaphragm up to 20 micron thick can be produced using the boron to stop the KOH etching. So you will be using the boron to stop the KOH etching. So you will be using this KOH. So boron will stop that etching, and that will form a diaphragm. So the concentrated dependent on the etching, so this is called as a concentration dependent etching. So whenever you are using a boron to stop the etching process, that is called as a concentration dependent etching. So the thickness of the diaphragm is dependent on the depth of which the boron is diffused into silicon and can be controlled accurately. So if you control the boron diffusion into silicon accurately, you can control the etching process accurately with the help of this one also. So the boron impurities are usually introduced into silicon by the process of diffusion. So the in addition to the diaphragm, many other structures can be built with the help of concentration dependent etching. So the thick oxide mask is formed over the silicon wafer, and the surface is exposed to the boron diffusion. So here it is, the example is given. So what is that? Just a minute. Okay, now this is the silicon. You can get it as the silicon. The oxide layer is there, and that is get etched, and you expose it to the boron. So the boron gets diffused into this portion. So this is the boron diffusion. So I will say this is a boron. Okay, so that diffusion takes place. So you are diffusing the boron impurity into silicon. So that will get diffused into silicon to form the well of boron. So the oxide mask is stripped off. The second mask may be deposited and patterned. After a wafer is immersed into KOH bath, each bath, then the KOH etches the silicon is not protected by the mask. So here it is the example. Again, what you will do, you will again you will have the oxide layer on that one. So you have the oxide layer on that one. Now the oxide is not from this portion, it is not from this portion. So what you have to do, you have to etch it now. So what we'll do, we will keep this portion open. So this much portion is kept open, and it is etched. So this is etched with the KOH. So the boron is driven into the silicon as far as 20 micron over the period of 15 to 20 hours. So the concentration dependent etching can also be used to produce the narrow bridges or the cantilever beams that can be used in resonant sensors. So here it is the example. So the cantilever beam, so this is the boron structure, boron doped. So this is the boron doped, and below that, here just like this one, so you can see that this much the each part. So if I cut it like this, so I will consider this part is one, this one. So and if I look into this angle, so let us consider this much is the cantilever beam or the bridge. So this is the bridge which is formed from this end to this end, and this is the cantilever beam which is from so you will be using such kind of sensors which can be used for. So the cantilever beam will be formed, and these can be used in resonant sensors to have the resonance type of circuit. So in oscillations, you will be using that. Now the next technique is of dry etching technique. So we have seen the wet etching, we have seen the basic technique, and now we will be moving towards the dry etching. Then the dry etching type of technique. So the most of the common dry etching for the micro machining is known as reactive ion etching type of technique. That means RIE technique is used, where you will be using the reactive ion type of etching instead of chemicals. So ion is accelerated towards the material to be etched, and this etching reaction is enhanced in the direction of travel of the ion, and that ion will etch that particular part. So it is just like I'll give the example of that, the beam, light beam, that you will call it as a laser beam, and when you groove it on any surface, that may be a wooden part, that may be a steel, or that may be other type of, so when that light falls on that surface, and that will get carved. So this carving type of technique is, you may call it as a dry etching type of technique. Okay, so RIE is an anisotropic type of etching technique. So previously we have seen that is an isotropic type of technique, and if you are using the KOH, then it is a anisotropic type of etching technique. Then the deep trenches or the pits of arbitrary shape with a vertical walls can be etched in variety of the materials, including silicon, oxide and nitrides. So if you are using this one, so you'll be getting a sharp cuts with the help of such kind of dry etching. Then RIE is not limited to the crystal plane. So previously the crystal plane, you should have a crystal orientation in the same direction to have a sharp edges. But here that is not the technique. So if the orientation is not proper, then also you can use this technique for proper edge cutting. So the combination of dry etching and isotropic wet etching can be used to form a sharp points. So you can have a sharp points. Let us see with the help of example. So column with a vertical slides is etched away using RIE technique. So this is how you can use it with the help of RIE techniques. So you can see that this is a silicon, and with the dry etching, you are simply cutting this in a sharp edges. So this much portion is etched out, this much portion is etched out, so this much portion is etched out with the help of RIE technique. Now I want a sharp edge over here like this. Now I cannot go for a RIE type of technique, then I can use a wet technique. So the wet etching is used which undercuts the etch mask. That means this cutting we need to consider it. So this etching will be done with the help of wet mask. So here you can see that here we'll be getting a pointed type of silicon. So in most of the applications you need a pointed sensor. So this is the technique how you can manufacture a pointed type of sensor. Then after that you can remove this etch mask and you can have a silicon with a pointed sensor type of application. So then each mask is removed, and very fine points like it can be fabricated on the end of the cantilever beam, such as probe for use specifically for the tactile sensors. Such kind of dry etching type of technique along with a combination of wet etching is used to form a pointed type of sensors. Then there is another technique that is called as a lift-off technique. There is another technique which is also called as a lift-off technique. So that lift-off technique is just like a stenciling technique, often used to pattern the noble metal films. So the thin films that are assisting the materials are deposited on the surface. We will call it as oxide. So the layer of the oxide resist is put over this pattern, use photolithography, and it is exposed to the oxide in the pattern desired for the metal. So here we have already seen such kind of application initially, but this photolithography technique is used. The mask is formed. This is oxide layer, this is oxide layer, and on which you will be having the mask, and that mask will be cut, and what will happen, the oxide is then wet etched so that to undercut the resist, so you will be getting such kind of etching of oxide layer. Then the metal is deposited on the wafer by evaporation process. We have already seen the evaporation process in the previous technique. So the metal is deposited on the silicon surface. We have seen the deposition processes, different sputtering method and chemical deposition method. So such methods, you deposit the metal film on this surface, and the metal pattern is effectively stenciled with the gaps in the resist, and that is removed with lifting of the unwanted metal with it. So you remove the mask, and then whatever may be the circuit you want to print it, or whatever may be the pattern you want to print it on that, so that pattern is stenciled on that one, and other part is removed. So the assisting layer is stripped off too, leaving the metal pattern alone, and so the oxide layer is also removed, and you will get the sensor like this one. So a silicon substrate on which a structured metal film will be there. So that structured metal film will form your thin film for your sensor. Now you have already developed such kind of technique. Now you want a multi-layer structure, then in that case you need to bond the wafers. So to form a longer complex devices, the micro machining wafers need to be bonded together to the other substrates or to the other material by various methods. So the popular method of bonding is silicon to the gloss is anodic type of bonding, which is also called as a electrostatic type of bonding. Then the silicon wafer and the glass substrates are brought together and heated with high temperature, heated at a high temperature. So the large electric field is applied to join the joints, which causes an extremely strong bond to form between the two materials. That means you are heating the material as well as you are applying the strong electric field, so that will join the two materials. So there is a glass plate bonded over the channel etched into silicon wafer. So most of the time you should have a glass on the your sensor, or the window you want to develop on a sensor. So in that case you need to bond the two materials. So for that purpose also this wafer bonding is used. So here it is how exactly you are doing. So you have already grooved this material in this pattern. So here it is, you can see that this is the pattern, and on that you are putting a glass as a substrate, or as a to protect that SI material with the help of the glass. So you want to protect with the glass, then you need to combine these silicon and the glass material. So what you will be doing that, so wafer bonding process will help you to bond these two separate materials together. So it is also possible to bond the silicon wafers directly together using the gentle pressure under the water. That is called as a direct silicon bonding type of material. So other bonding method, which includes the adhesive layer such as glass or a photoresist, so you can use the other adhesive layers also for a glass and photoresist. Then anodic bonding and the direct solution, direct silicon bonding requires a very flat and a clean surface, whereas for adhesive layer you don't require such kind of techniques. So the wafer bonding technique can potentially be combined with some of the basic micro machine structures to form the membranes, cantilevers, walls, pumps, etc. for microfluid. So we are talking about the MEMS, we are talking about the nanotechnology. So here we will be manufacturing the small membranes, we will be manufacturing the small cantilevers, we are manufacturing the small valves of the micron levels, or the pumps of which will handle the microfluid systems specifically for the chemical sensors. And with that, we came to the end of this nano type of technology. Hope you might have understood the everything. If you have any difficulty, you can post it and I will try to satisfy your query. Thank you very much. You can visit the YouTube channel Tech Fundas and you can go through the videos and you can put your queries, or you can subscribe the channel and you can like the video. Thank you.